Introduction to myself. I'm from IBM, China R&D Center. My mainly work experience focus on open source community. In the beginning, open office, then to open stack, and then 2016. And afterwards, focus on R&D with serverless platform. In the open Apache community. So starting from this year, I began to notice on another project. So I'm going to focus on the building of a Kubernetes platform. These are the topics I will cover today. First of all, introduction to serverless and Apache OpenWhisk. Next, to share with you about IoT applications and the representative architecture and features. Also within this architecture and features, what applications can be delivered for serverless. The fourth part is to connect the events into IoT on the Apache serverless. So first of all, what is serverless? Two different explanations. One is functions as a service. Another is backend as a service. Functions as a service refers to this small segment of code and execution based on needs. And the scalability based on needs. No need for the administration for any relating infrastructure parts, and also the event-driven calculation. So now most manufacturers refer to function as a service for serverless. But meanwhile, it also covers the wider range for concept, which is backend service or BaaS, which means the third party of this API service, and it will help to achieve the fundamental function modules in the development, and no need for administration, and it will automatically scale up like API services. So be it for functions as a service or backend as a service, refers to administration free and scalability based on needs. So if for functions as a service, this would be the gateway driven and event driven. And scalability and payment will be based on needs. In the beginning of the cloud computing, we always say that this is like consuming water or electricity. And actually now this cannot be achieved. Within 1 week, if we call 3 times for the service, then this service would be continuously operated. But if we have a serverless, only within the 3 times of calling, the service would be installed onto your computing platform. So this achieves consumption of the computing resources just like consuming water and electricity. And we can achieve fast iteration, fast development, because what you face is the holistic cloud platform. And if you need it, it can execute. This is also friendly for developers and bring new development experiences for them. The developers can start from their own role to transfer their role to the 10-year-old primary school student, or even to the 20-year-old artist, because what they need to do is very simple, and they can finish the code and then to run it on the server. Also, they will expose the HTTP address to the others for use, and also payment charge is very low. So what is the Apache OpenWhisk? This is the event-driven and code-executed fast platform. Now, the Apache community has this incubation project. Also, This has been verified on the public platform of IBM. We also use the same core lines of code as OpenWhisk. Within OpenWhisk, they have the concept or philosophy of coding. The event works as a trigger, so you need to put your main businesses into this event. This is the segment of a code, be it a Python or Node.js. This is a function. You can define a event source after it happened. This will be triggered. So this is the philosophy programming. Some concepts including trigger rules, because you need to contact trigger an event, so this is rule. And action is your code, and also package the same. It can pack the different things within a package. So the main application scenarios, every scenario naturally belong to a kind of microservice, because it runs at the server end. It also has address for you to call. After calling, it will execute for 1 to 2 minutes as a service. So we can regard this as a naturally microservice platform, and also fits for IoT platform. More details for you to have a deep dive. Also, this is used on DevOps. So after the trigger, it will generate the image and then to trigger it further. So this is the process for DevOps, and these are the very representative scenarios. Next, let's have a look at IoT, which is Internet of Things. Now this is a trend, which means the different physical devices can be connected through network and can be programmed. So you can imagine this. For environment sensors, these are deployed in every corner of the world to measure the air and environment, and then to upload this information to the cloud for integration, and also your wearable band, the band device can also measure your biometric information, and also we have the industrial computer to integrate the information from different metrics in the factories for error detection or forecast detection. Also we have the V2X. This is also a part of the IoT, because now cars can be connected. In addition, I believe if you use Xiaomi devices, maybe you have Xiaomi smart home devices. So these devices can be connected and onto the cloud, just the air conditioners or your fridges or the other home appliances can be controlled online by the manufacturers. And now we have the basic control for the temperature control and haven't reached smart level. In the future, we will have more popularization of the smart devices, and we will reach the IoT atmosphere for real. So what are the characteristics for IoT applications? First of all, this is a big data attribute, and also the heterogeneous, because we have millions, billions of IoT devices and generating billions of data, normally connected by gateway. Also, on the gateway, it will have a preliminary processing, maybe cleaning or transfer of format. The data processed by gateway then migrated onto the cloud for storage and analyze. These four refer to the data flow in the internet, or the process, the flow. So the heterogeneous big data would be connected by gateway and then uploaded to the cloud, and then for storage and the analysis. We cannot make forecasts. For example, when to receive the data and when will we have the anomalies, and when to transmit the data. So if we have IoT processing services 24/7, will we wait here for the data to execute, or we can use a serverless capability? When we have the data, it will trigger. By doing so, the resources of computing costs could be reduced. So this is the serverless and its typical applications in the IoT scenario. This is a very typical IoT application architecture on the basis of IBM Cloud. The most right side is through MQTT devices uploaded to IoT platform. And down below is the message hub. Message hub will have two directions. One direction to store it on the object storage. Another, we have a streaming analysis app. Apps analysis and streaming analysis would have real time processing. Also, we will have a visualization machine learning capabilities, or we can mine something in the historic record belong to data science. This is only a very simple example case to share with you. So within this example, what are the potential areas for serverless to play or to exert its advantages? We think that serverless can play a very important role in these four different areas. The first is part A. The object will go through message hub and transmit it to object storage. And before this, we can insert a segment of code. And this code, because the message has been transmitted to message hub, so can be triggered by this event. Afterwards, we can get the message hub transmitted original data, and then this could be filed, this could be archived. Also, we can have formatting or the other processing, and this would make it easier for storage and analysis. Another scenario in part B. After storage of data, OpenWhisk can use ETL as a method for processing, to process the data or to search for the other information to augment, enhance the data. For example, the data relates to third-party data only have a key value. So here, according to the key value, we can search for the third-party data and to enrich it. After this part, this will be used for driving the machine learning and AI. So this is what we do after storage relating to before entering the phase of ML machine learning, we can insert a segment of serverless code for the server processing. And this could reach the trigger on time. Let's have a look at real-time data processing, which is flow data detection. We also can use OpenWhisk for execution or serverless actions, serverless functions to execute the specific tasks for triggering the feedback. For example, in this flow, we can intercept the specific events for processing. For example, on the street, on the road, the vehicles have V2X. If we discover congestions on the road, and when the congestion reaches a certain threshold value, it can trigger the scheduling of the traffic light to avoid the congestion on the road. So in flow processing, it could be used to process the specific events. The last scenario, the edge computing serverless capability. So on the edge, the serverless can also play its role. Maybe you have heard of edge computing widely. So hereby, we can also leverage the serverless capability. By doing so, the edge and the cloud can enjoy the same capability, but now still in R&D. So this is a trend for the future. This is a real example case. from IBM, a real client scenario, what they need to do is like this. Inside their company, they have developed some specific devices for the capture of audio messages and audio data. We want to detect the abnormal scenarios and trigger alarming. This could be used in the baby sitting. For example, if your baby cries on the second floor and you're on the first floor, then you will receive information on your smartphone saying that your baby is crying. Or in your home, especially smart home, when you hear some noisy, when you're sitting in the very quiet environment, maybe it will send you a alerting information. So on the right, the data would be captured by this device made by this manufacturer. On the upper right, and the audio data will first go through two different flows. One is enter IBM Watson IoT platform, another object storage platform.
然后，这个对象存储的这个平台呢，
the object storage platform
有一个函数叫做
heavy function.
就是这些第三个方框，一个是
these three parts. One is orange, one is blue, another is a brown.
And in the brown one, it is the function run on the serverless platform. And then it is to analyze the process sound to see if the sound is normal. If there is any anomaly, it will process a warning. And then it will trigger a machine learning scenario. This machine learning scenario means if you analyze a certain scenario very often and you detect the sound of the rain in it, and you can remove the raining sound, and this could be actually be done by machine learning gradually. And then the brown part is for sound progressing to augment the sound or to remove the raining sound, which is learned through machine learning gradually. And after removing the raining sound, and if any theft sound is detected, it will trigger the warning. So in this scenario, actually, it is adopting scenario 2 and 3. It is to monitor any anomaly and to give a warning. And in scenario 2, after the data storage, it will also have a data augmentation. Finishing talking about data, let's then look at the event. Because on IoT platform, data is important as well as event. On Apache OpenWhisk, the event processing capability is here is good, and we can see the package on the OpenWhisk. How many packages there are means its capability to deal with these events. It could monitor the Kafka and also through the pushing notifications to trigger. And it could be integrated together with Jira, and it could trigger event in DevOps. And it also has a RSS subscription. And when the subscription is updated, it would also trigger the event, and it could also be integrated with the CushDB. And when the DB is updated, it will also trigger the event. So for IBM Cloud, with some development and integration on the IBM Cloud platform, the events could be processed, including the DB and event stream, which refers to the Kafka message. And the customer trigger means, for example, I have a message sent to a specific RESTful and it could also trigger the event, or with some mobile push to trigger, and on GitHub, if anything is updated, it could be triggering the event as well. And there will also be the periodic triggering. These are the event processing capabilities on the IBM Cloud platform now. And if you want to access the event to the serverless platform, you want to figure out how. And now for most the serverless platform, they would support Kafka. So at least you can send your message onto Kafka. And any message on Kafka would trigger a function. And for OpenWhisk platform, we have a customized event accessing model. For example, you have an event monitor. And whatever you monitor, event or a function, if it is for a long time running, the monitor would definitely detect the event, and then you would program a function on the serverless platform, which is called an OpenWhisk action, and then it would be transmitted to OpenWhisk platform, and then it could be mobilized in two ways, through API or through URL. And for most serverless platforms, they could be capable of this. If you transmit a function onto it, it would feedback you with a domain name, and through the domain name, you could try to mobilize the action. So the first part of your job is to develop an event monitor, and the second is to develop an event processing logic, and the monitor would be running for a long time, and it could detect any event, and then to mobilize the event function, and with the serverless capability, when it is not mobilizing, it is in the sleep mode, which will not any of your occupied computing resource. This is a very simple accessing mode, but of course there would be more complicated ones. Now this is the end of my presentation. Any question? Any requirement for this deployment? My question is on-premise deployment of this platform. Any requirement for private cloud? Yes. Well, I think for private cloud deployment, it's no problem, because for OpenWhisk, it could be deployed on Kubernetes. It could be deployed on any platform that supports Docker image. You can deploy just the Kubernetes and OpenWhisk, it is done. But with a larger and larger scale of the computation, it might be bigger. What would be bigger? I mean, more demands for computing. You mean more requests come? Will it also be scaling up horizontally? Yes. For the serverless platform, generally, the serverless means the developer would not pay attention to the server end, but as the operator maintainer, we still need to pay attention to that. If the hardware is not sufficient, we need to add more hardware. My question is for private cloud. We have the container deployed, which could be scaling up and down as well. Then, what would be more special about serverless platform in this case?
Well,
the scaling, the elastic scaling, like from 1 to n, is like this, but for serverless, it could be scaled up from 0 to n. Actually, now Kubernetes is able to achieve this. It means my service does not require running here 7/24. hours, 7 days, 24 hours. But when it waits for others to implement it, I still recommend serverless. But the first trigger for serverless would take some time because it is based on the code starting. If it evolves container, then for the first time trigger, it may need at least 1 second, and you need to judge whether or not you could accept this 1 second. First of all, you save the resources, and when there is no trigger, it would not execute. And for the first time, it might take some longer time, but within 5 seconds, if 50 requests come, it could scale horizontally very quickly. This could be achievable. Please hand over the microphone to him. For serverless platform now, most would not support long connection. But for serverless, this concept has been evolving. We used to talk about stateless serverless, but now we are talking about serverless with a state. Status. But so we often hear the client saying that they want a longer time running of it. But if they require a longer time for the running, they could just have a pod or deployment on the Kubernetes. They do not need serverless platform. Well, my question is that for serverless, is it similar to Google's Firebase? Is it also a function as a service platform? Yes. Seems you don't know that. Right, I don't know much about it. Okay, then for the serverless, as you mentioned, it could also run the Java. Script,
yes.
So it means you can do with any server with it. You can write in any language, yes. You can write in any language and you upload it onto the platform, and when you need it, it could help you mobilize that language and function.
My question is,
it could be compared with AWS
Lambda.
It is like an open source version of Lambda.
Yes. You also mentioned Docker.
So it also makes use of the Docker.
Yes, for Lambda it's not
Docker. So if you have a new request from 0 to 1, you could have the Docker and also cold starting.
Yes,
but we have some optimization. We could prepare some container pool in advance. If you need a Docker image and run a Node.js application on the Docker image, we could in advance start the Node.js environment for you, and this environment is already except for putting into your program, but it would occupy some resource. You can just put it there, make it ready to reduce the cool starting part, but actually it is not cool starting, it is to optimize it, yes. Well, there were some people asking about whether or not it supports all image, yes. Then how about the on-premise loading? If you upload the image, you could not realize on-premise loading. There are actually two modes. For image, we call it black box. For a container, it is just to lift it, but we don't know what's in the container. Now Kubernetes is also making the serverless platform, yes. So how do you compare? Well, for IBM, we invest, we input into both communities, and I think they would both exist in the future. My question is not very relevant to it, but I want to ask, for a different language, runtime, the starting time would be vary largely? And how would you optimize this? Well, this is a very good question. I would like to share with you some of my viewpoints. And I know that for code starting time, it's mainly spent on lifting the container. But for Node.js and Java, Java would be slower than Node.js. But I think the time is still very minimum compared with the container starting time, so it could be neglected. I remember you started this project back in 2016, and it's 3 years past. And how do you see the future direction for serverless platform? Any trend? Well, I think at the beginning we talked about to save resources with serverless platform because it could adopt the pay as you need, pay as you use mode. But when we talk about serverless platform's future, I think it is to offer new experience to the developer so that the developer could enjoy some cloud development capability more. So serverless, I think it was initiated in 2012, and by 2016, the evolution of it is not finished, and it will keep on. And personally speaking, the future cloud platform will become a cloud OS. Programming on cloud would mobilize a lot of APIs, and it will be supported by the cloud capability to realize your logic. But now, if locally you write a Node.js script and some image processing capability might be from the local, but if it is on cloud, it will be based on the cloud capability. So I believe in the future, with the more development of the serverless platform, it will be more of a cloud OS. Another important trend for serverless would be eventing, about event and cloud events. In addition to the OS capability, you also have various events to trigger. I believe that is an important direction for serverless development.
You mentioned event,
which is an important direction for serverless in the future. Now for CNCF, we have a cloud event. And do you think that is related to the eventing here for serverless? I know about cloud event, which is for cloud native, and for OpenWhisk, we now do not have the plan. You also mentioned the cloud native and IBM's participation into it. IBM in the cloud native community has input a lot. We are involved in all blocks here. Time's up. Any more question?
Okay.
Now we close this session. Thank you for listening.